Good morning, church.
Good morning.
It's quite as we gather on this day. Today is a special day as we gather to celebrate communion on this World Communion Sunday. When our brothers and sisters in Christ across the globe are breaking bread and sharing the cup that we also share, to remind us of our oneness with Christ, our oneness with each other, and our oneness in ministry to the world until Christ comes in final victory. What a joy it is to journey in discipleship with you. If you're a guest with us, I want to say a special welcome to you as we worship today. Let's go to God in prayer. God, we thank you for this day. It is a day that, God, you are filling with your grace and your love. It is a day that we come and we ask you to fill our lives with the fullness of God, that we could experience the joyful and meaningful life in Christ. Amen. Thank you.
join together in song, I would like to point out a couple of special guests who happen to be named Surface, who joined us today.
Oh, where? Where?
It's a blessing to have them and to be here with all of you. Please join me in singing Love Divine, All Loves You Come.
Like a pop quiz. Okay? Three questions. Yes,
God's help.
We will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround Catherine Ann with a community of love and forgiveness, that she may grow in her knowledge of God, love of people, and service to others. We will pray for Catherine Ann, that she may grow as a disciple who will walk in the way that leads to life.
Catherine Ann, we baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty and gracious God, I just pray that you will continue the great work that you have begun in Catherine, that she will continue to experience your love, that she will continue to receive your grace, and that she will continue to be a witness of you, God, and of your Son, Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit, that she will continue with her wonderful smile to share the joy of what it means to be in Christ. Amen. Members of the household of God, Catherine Ann, a child of God.
Wow, he was good, wasn't he? I think he did great. doesn't. Simon, you have a point for this?
Sure do. I think we should imitate Jesus.
Oh, very good. We should imitate Jesus. How? What can we do today to imitate Jesus, to be like Jesus?
Just this.
Thank you. for. There is someone here who has been instrumental in many of our lives of discipleship, and it is Pastor Deb's life for being here. And we want to say thank you for the ministry that that you've done here, and bless you on the ministry that you will continue to do at First United Church in Dalton. I hope that you will all join us following this service and the fellowship call to wish him well as well. And Lauren has a little something she'd like to share with us.
And as you are partnering in this congregation, do you covenant to faithfully participate in the ministries of First Baptist Church of Lane through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your goodness? I know you do, and you have been doing that, because I know you've been doing so much of that. And so, members of the household of God, I have been Charles, for your love and your care, do all you can to nurture him in the faith, strengthen him in hope, and confirm him in love. Let us make our response. We give thanks
for all that God has already given to you, and we love you.
Thank you, Amber, for doing that again. Thank you, Fire, because you prayed him. You've sung that again once. No, we sing it maybe once or twice a year. I have experience of singing this song every Monday, Wednesday, Friday at 7:30 in the morning to start reading class. One of my friends in Greek class, his name was Brett. Brett was a clown. And as college students, you know, you can try to have fun. Brett was a great guy. And one year close to Halloween, he decided it would be fun to get an airline pilot's costume. Dress Brett up in that and go down to San Diego Airport. And have Brett walk around asking people to help him get his flight 5967. Now it was fun until security said, you can't. No, sometimes you can't smack fun in the face. Can't is a four-letter word that we use all too often. For me, it might be just me, but can't is the antonym of the possible, of the possible that God can do. Sometimes can't smack faith in the fence. Now, just for fun, at the next committee meeting you attend, or the next ministry team meeting you attend, count how many times can't is used as opposed to can. Or how many times you yourself think it. Because sometimes can't smack straight in the face. Can't should never really characterize it. I'll tell you a story this morning of one whose life was characterized, really characterized by can't. I mean, Brett, his life was characterized by can't. He can't see. He can't use a regular textbook. He can't take a written exam. He can't fill out those scantrons back in the day when you use those to register for classes. He can't see the ocean view from the ocean view bar. And he can't. He can't fly himself, can't go to the plane by himself. Now you would think his life might be characterized by can't, but Frank actually characterized his life by can't. He had a very respectable grade point average, was in student leadership, and he serves as the headmaster of a private Christian school. There's a story of another person in the Bible whose life was characterized by can't, and we read that story in Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8. And it's a story of how the word of God is spreading. Jesus has been resurrected and sent the Holy Spirit, 12 new witnesses, and the apostles are spreading the word. And it's going out from Jerusalem and even into the area of Judea and into Samaria. And it's from Acts chapter 8, starting at verse 26. And as one whose character, his life is characterized by can't, until the Holy Spirit guide in all. It starts with a story. An angel from the Lord spoke to Philip, and he took the road that leads from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert road. So he did. Meanwhile, an Ethiopian man was on his way home from Jerusalem, where he had come to worship. He was a eunuch and an official responsible for the entire treasury of Candace. Candace is the title given to the Ethiopian queen. Can you imagine a life characterized by Candace? Now, into the story of the gospel spreading, Luke parenthetically just inserts a story about an Ethiopian man. We don't know his name. Actually, knowing his name is a little consequence to the story according to Luke. But what he is critical and vital to the story as a unit. Not just about the physical condition, but how it characterizes his life. Now, since he was a eunuch, he had probably been a prisoner of war or a victim of extreme poverty. Because those were the groups that suffered such physical humiliation. And at the same time, they're given places of within the empire. It was just a matter of pragmatics. Because as a eunuch, he was neither a threat to the males nor the females. And it was just a matter of pragmatics. And he is the treasurer in charge of the entire treasury of the king of Ethiopia. And he had gone to worship. He had gone to worship in Jerusalem, and he's making his way home. And he pulls over and he starts, and then he says, in verse 28, he was reading the prophet Isaiah while sitting in his carriage. Now perhaps he was reading what the scripture was in the temple. And the Spirit told Philip, approach the carriage and stand there. And so you have an angel of the Lord speaking to Philip, saying, go take this road. And now you have the Holy Spirit prompting Philip. This prompting is saying, go over to that carriage. And Philip is open to the prompting of the Holy Spirit. He had other things on his calendar that day, by the way. He had other plans, other things he wanted to do that day, but now the Holy Spirit interrupts his plans for the day and his agenda. He's open to the prompting of the Holy Spirit. Are you open to the prompting of the Holy Spirit in your day? Or your calendar is too long? Are you open to the prompting of the Holy Spirit to direct you in God's priorities, or are you so caught up in your own preferences? The Spirit told Philip, approach the carriage. Standing. Running up to the carriage, Philip does this with eagerness and urgency, responding to the prompting of the Holy Spirit. Running up to the carriage, Philip heard the man reading the prophet Isaiah, and he asked, do you really understand what you are reading? And the eunuch replied, without someone to guide me, how could I? Then he invited Philip to climb up and sit with him. So Philip runs over and he says, do you understand what you're reading? And the man says, can't. That this eunuch lived the life of can't. And he now is led over to his life of faith. When he went to the temple, he was not able to go to the main part of the sanctuary where you are sitting. He was excluded from that, according to the law of Deuteronomy. Well, I can't worship with everybody else. And now he says, you know, well, I can't even understand scripture. And his life of can't, his life characterized by can't, he's bleeding over his life of faith. Now, if you don't have any other takeaway from today, take away this. When you do your daily Bible reading, when you do your daily Bible reading, don't be so caught up in trying to understand it as much as just experience it. Philip is sharing the good news to someone who had excluded from the good news. Couldn't even worship expected answers. He expected answers. Now, he was a eunuch who had been prevented his whole life. He was prevented from the audience, enjoying the intimacy. Now, he's prevented from asking somebody in my first date, you know, how exciting, remember? You know, you remember how exciting it was? Proposing marriage, having a family, prevented from having a family, having a child run up to you when you get home and say, oh, man, he's home. Prevented from all that. And he's been prevented from things of God. He wasn't able to come along with Christ, he wasn't able to worship in the main part of the sanctuary, he wasn't able to be with the other men. He was excluded from the United Methodist men's breakfast. Couldn't go to Bible study, couldn't partake of communion. I mean, he was probably excluded from Catholics. And his life has been one of things. And so he simply asks, what does keep me from being baptized? And he expects fellows to say, well, you're a new man. You can't be baptized. You're not good enough. You're not like one of us. You haven't been a member long enough. You know, you got this or that in your past. And the eunuch says, what does prevent me from being baptized? And Philip gives no answer because there is no answer to him. There is no answer to that question. And they go down to the wall where Philip was baptized. And now his life can't. Has become a way of king. Sometimes faith comes as can't. And I think about Abraham and Sarah, they're aged, way beyond childbearing years, and God calls them to have numerous children. They say can't, God says can. The people wandering in the wilderness say, we can't take this. We have no food, no water. God gives them water from a rock, sends manna, sends quail. They say, we can't. God says, you can. Or when they're getting ready to enter the promised land, they send 12 spies. 10 come back and say, we can't. 2 say, we can. And the majority ruled. They said, we can't. Or Mary, a young virgin. Teenage years. God says, you're going to give birth to my son. She says, I can't. God says, yes, you can. People said, Jesus, you can't forgive sins. God says, yes, you can. You can't be resurrected from the dead. The power of God says, yes, you can. You can't have new life. God says, yes, you can. Here's this person who now has changed. From can to can. What is stopping him? What is keeping him from a full, meaningful life? In Christ. This person who lived a life of can't, he didn't have any family, but that was part of God's family. He was excluded from worship in the sanctuary, but now he's part of the body of Christ. He was prevented from intimacy, but now he has an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. What is keeping you? What is keeping you from a full, meaningful life in Christ? Now, in some churches, not this church, of course, in some churches, I've had people that seem like they live their life characterized by the agony of defeat. Remember the agony of defeat? Do you remember that? Just in case you don't, I want to show it to you.
Thank you.
the spear just went away with a few bruises. And he fell intentionally. That was not an accident. He decided to change his course because the smoke had gotten too icy. He was going too fast. If he didn't jump, he would go get on the safe landing area. He could seriously injure himself, maybe other people by landing in the crowd, maybe even something failed him. So instead of that, he just decided to change course. Take a point. Yeah. It's not too late to change your course. If we're not experiencing the full, joyful life in Christ, it was not too late for this Ethiopian eunuch to let the Holy Spirit change his course and let him experience a full, meaningful, joyful life in Christ. We're stopping. You know, we come up with our answers, don't we? Well, I can't because I've got this and that going on. Well, I can't because of, or I can't because, you know, I have this in my past, or I can't because God can't forgive that. But what is stopping you from a joyful life in Christ? I can't give you an answer because there's no answer to it. There's just no answer. I think what we should do is take all these cans. Anybody got a few cans going through your mind? I think what we should do is just take those cans and let the Holy Spirit just move those out. And put the joyfulness of Christ in there. And so when we come to the table today, when we come to the communion, bring those cans with you. Take them, bring them to the altar. And say, I can't. And let God say, I can. You say, I can't. You're going to say, I can. And as you ingest those gifts of grace, let those can'ts be moved away and let God's grace fill your heart. So you can have a life centered in Christ, a life that is filled with grace, a joyful and meaningful life in Christ. What is stopping you from that? There is no answer to you. I cannot give you an answer because there is no answer. Amen.
This morning we celebrate Holy Communion. Remember that this table spans much, much further, much wider than we can even fathom. As we celebrate Holy Communion, with people all around the world. And so this morning, as we prepare for Holy Communion, let us join together in a great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. God of all nations, you created every person in your image and called us by your Holy Spirit to become one in Christ Jesus. Through baptism and through faith. In Jesus Christ, you showed us the way to live with unique gifts and particularities, yet in harmony with you and with each other. You, O God, are dear above all and through all and in all. So today we join with voices throughout the earth and in heaven saying,
and when Jesus ate,
his final meal with his disciples. They remembered that blessing on the multitude, and they listened to him as he said, "Take heed. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
They watched as Jesus then took the cup and blessed it. He said, "Take, drink. This is the cup of the new covenant that's poured out for you and for the whole world. Forgiveness of sins." After his death and resurrection, by the power of the Holy Spirit, the disciples told others through this meal that Jesus was the Messiah sent by God for all humanity. Remembering now, we proclaim the mystery of the faith. God, pour out your Holy Spirit on all that are gathered and on these gifts of gratitude. May it be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be the body of Christ redeemed by his name. Make us one with you, Lord. Make us one with each other. And make us one in ministry to all the world until we feast to that heaven. All glory and honor is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Invite those that are helping to serve communion, and those that need to serve first, if you would make your way forward. We do communion by intention. You're given a piece of bread today and dip in a cup. Take some time to kneel and pray. If you have an opportunity, if you'd like to participate in communion or offering, this is for World Communion Sunday. It goes to help international students continue their education. If you need it gluten-free, if you need gluten-free, and or the individual cups, if you make your way to this meal here and put your hands up, then Chapter Bill folks will be happy to serve.
given yourself to us, and you have called us to go and give ourselves to others, to share the good news of Jesus Christ, makes all things possible. God, if we did not believe it was possible, we wouldn't even pray. But we know that through our prayers, all things are possible. For the prayers that we've offered this day, God, we just pray with the power of the Holy Spirit that you would give the confidence that you are already at work. And as we pray together the prayer that Jesus Christ taught us to pray, Lord, fill us with the confidence of your children. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Jesus, Jesus, praise the Lord.
want you to be filled with the strength that God can provide you through the riches of His glory. I want your lives to be filled with the love of Christ so that you will experience the fullness of God. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.